Please welcome to the stage 2023 NRF Foundation Next Generation Scholarship finalist, Lauren Schmall.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Lauren Schmall. I'm a senior at Indiana University studying merchandising, and I, alongside Olivia and Clay, am an NRF Foundation Next Generation finalist. I'm so excited to introduce our next session, Accelerate Your Career, the NRF Foundation Young Professionals panel. Retail has the power to build extraordinary careers, and these young professionals are here today to share their experiences working in the retail industry. This morning, you have all had the unique opportunity to learn from these individuals as they discuss their roles and experiences and how they have built their careers so far. Robert Davidson Long, Donna Department Manager at Prada, will moderate this morning's panel. Robert has been in the industry for 10 years and has a passion for people above all. He has worked for brands including Express, The Fry Company and Coach, and is now the Women's Department Manager at the Prada flagship store in Chicago. In 2022, he was recognized as the top recipient for the NRF Foundation Next Generation Scholarship. Please join me in welcoming them to the stage.
Good morning, good morning. How are you guys doing? Great, great, great. So Lauren has already introduced me, so I would just want to jump right in and introduce the rest of the panel.
Okay. Hi, everyone. My name is Courtney Nash. I am thrilled to be here speaking with you guys today. I think we're supposed to say a little bit about our career path. I want to just keep my intro really brief so we can get to my other colleagues and have time for questions at the end. But I just celebrated my one-year anniversary with Allbirds. If you do not know Allbirds, we have been named the world's most comfortable shoe. We are a B Corporation with some serious sustainability goals. And I work in the supply chain planning and merchandise planning space. Prior to Allbirds, I joined Gap Inc.'s rotational management program right after college, where I got to learn production, merchandising, and inventory management. I was placed with Athleta, and I got to start my inventory management career with them. I will keep that at what it is for now, so we can move on to the others.
Great. Hi, everyone. My name is Amaya Sims. I'll keep my intro short as well. I am a CEO and founder of Amaya's Atelier, which is a fashion styling agency in Chicago. I'm also the assistant stylist for ShopBop and Nordstrom, in which I help out with their online marketing teams as well as corporate photo studio. I received my master's from Columbia College Chicago in entrepreneurship, where I also studied fashion merchandising. So I'll pass it to Eugene.
Awesome. Thanks. I'm Eugene Choi. I am currently based in Phoenix, Arizona as a senior site merchandiser at PetSmart. I've been there about a year and a half and started there as a rotational right out of college. Before that, I interned at Target and I started my retail career at a small business. So retail has really been a big part of my life throughout, and can't wait to hear the rest of these questions.
Alrighty, so let's just dive right in. Our first question is, what drew you to retail? What was the defining moment when you knew that retail was the industry for you? And how have you continued to channel that passion as your career advances?
Sure, so something I didn't add in my intro is that I went to the University of Arizona, which I heard is in the crowd, so okay, thank you. Bear down. So my defining moment was the retailing and consumer sciences program at my university is top notch, if I do say so myself. So my defining moment, fortunately, I was 17. I was choosing my major, and rather than checking the business box, I chose the retail box. So I really was fortunate to know when I was pretty young that I wanted to really mold that business side, fashion side, and really decide to study that and get that consumer science side of it as well. So I had the passion really early on, but I was fortunate enough to study it in college and then have that kind of kickstart my career.
That's beautiful. Mine actually came not that long ago. I was just like you guys. I attended the NRF student program in 2020, and that's really where I learned what retail was. It's more than just a store that is that exchanges goods, or it's really a holistic experience for customers and even the people that work in retail. And from listening to all the different speakers, the leaders at the student program, I was really drawn to the qualities that they have, how resilient they are, and I knew that that was something that I wanted to grow within myself. And so I'm always trying to examine what they have, how they continue on their businesses, their business model, and look at myself, cross-examine, and expand on those daily.
Yeah. When I moved here, I was about 7 or 8, and retail was my first touch point with kind of the United States and the American culture. I mean, I remember like watching the Macy's Thanksgiving Parade and be like, that's really cool, you know, learning English by shopping at Nordstrom, learning some Swedish shopping at IKEA, I don't know. so it's been a big part of just learning about the world, and I took that into kind of my first retail job. Like I mentioned, I worked at a small business. It's a quilt store called Sewing Party. Now, I don't know how to sew. I don't. Maybe party, but not sew. So I had to learn a lot about just understanding the customer and, you know, doing marketing in a way that is authentic and speaks to people that were shopping our store. That store was founded by my mom, who's here today. So thank you, Mom. Hope that was a good shout out for you. But yeah, she's really helped me kind of decide on joining the retail program at Santa Clara University. I don't think we have any students here, unfortunately, but through that, just continue to grow more in my passion and love for retail.
That's really good.
And then for me, my journey started probably a little bit younger. My mom is a huge shopaholic, so I would always go, shopping with her. And the connection that she made with the retail people that were helping her and the feeling that she would have when she would leave the stores was something that I immediately bonded with. You know, at the core, retail is people. You have to take care of the people. And seeing that experience with her immediately made me feel like I want to be a part of that. You know, and so I've been in retail for, you know, since I was 17 years old, and just moving through, you know, the different stores. Retail has a beautiful way of allowing you to touch many different people across many different brands, and that was something that kind of propelled me to, you know, to where I am right now. Alrighty, next question. Many of the students in the audience will be graduating in the next 1 or 2 years. Can you talk about steps you took or things you did while in college to prepare for your future and career? And then the second part of that is, how did your relationship with the NRF Foundation and your experience as a next generation scholar play a role in your career so far?
Yeah, I mean, I could go on and give you like the list of the resume things I did in college, but I think ultimately what like my piece of advice would be is when you're thinking about going after those interviews and those job applications, just get involved in things that you're excited to talk about. Like for me, it was working in a store. I was studying retailing, but I wanted to get that floor experience and find those leadership opportunities. Like just feel like you're doing something with your time outside of your academics where you can say, this is what I learned outside of school. I have leadership X, Y, and Z. I have retail floor experience. I have whatever it may be. As sorority leadership, fraternity leadership, there's a lot you can get involved in that just makes you very proud to speak to recruiters about, and that's what will make you stand out. So that's what really, I think, helped me with my getting involved. What I wanted to do was something I just was gonna be proud to speak on when I was going through interviews and job applications. And then the second part was about my relationship with the NRF?
Yes, how does your relationship with the NRF Foundation and your experience as a next generation scholar play a role in your career so far?
Cool, thank you.
You're welcome.
So I clearly got involved with NRF. I was in the NRFSA club, and then I got to come here 3 times when I was in college, coming my sophomore, junior, and senior year. So that kickstarted my relationship with the NRF, but having it now in my professional life has been really instrumental in giving me a platform of something very credible to speak to when I'm in room with leadership. So I can say, hey, like, did you hear about this thing the NRF is doing? Did you get that news recap? I can have this kind of credible source to say, I have a personal relationship with the NRF. Can we come to the career fair and recruit from these top-notch students? So it kind of gives me this platform to really speak on and say that I have this involvement that stemmed in college, and here's what I can do for my company that's mutually beneficial for them to come talk to students like you guys. So I'm gonna keep talking, so I'll pass it on.
No, that's great. I second everything that you said. For the first part of the question, as far as what I did towards the end of college, I really had conversations with people in places that I thought I wanted to take my career. So for example, I was weighing going to graduate school. I was weighing, should I become a stylist? Should I go the merchandising route? Should I go into planning? So I would talk to planners, I would talk to buyers, I would talk to stylists, I would talk to people that were in graduate school and say, what are the pros and cons? What are the things that you wish you should have done? What are things that you know now? And creating that list, it really helped me shape which way that I wanted to go. And once I realized that, I obviously got advice from teachers, mentors, but I really had to dig deep within myself and find the confidence just to go after it. Because honestly, at the end of the day, living with the thought of what if I do something instead of being scared and fearless to go out and do it is something that you can't afford, and you should just do it. And then as far as like how the NRF helped with that, I think they have been so instrumental in numerous of ways. They've opened doors for mentorship, speaking opportunities, and they've really expanded my network in ways that I can't even imagine. And then as far as the scholarship itself, that really opened the floodgates for me to go on to graduate school and made me feel comfortable in my decision with being entrepreneurial as far as the case study. The scholarship really pushes you to be innovative and tap into things that you never thought you were capable of before.
In college, of course, I would say I didn't have it all figured out, and I still don't think I do. I think I'm relatively young. Like when I think about how when I was applying for Next Generation Scholarship, like I reached out to Courtney because I saw she had one in the past, and like we talked and had a conversation and she gave me advice, and now we get to share the stage. And so you never know where things can take you. So take a chance. I mean, we're young, right? I don't know, I'm young. I look out to you all and I start to feel old. But I think we're in that place where it's okay to make mistakes. Mm-hmm. I think just put yourself out there. And even in your classes, like what are you learning besides just the curriculum, which is of course, like I forgot most of it, but like what did you learn about your skills with working with a team? Like communicating, like finishing things on a tight deadline. Like those are the questions that you're gonna get asked in an interview. And if you can kind of build yourself up and have those experiences, and those experiences could be outside of school, like of course jobs, internships are important, but so is networking. Getting to meet people, ask questions, really, even if it's not in your specific field of interest, there's so much intersection. We're all human, right? I think Mark talked about human-centered leadership, and that is it. Retail, at the end of the day, no matter how much it gets automated, it is human-centered. So just think about that. Like, I had a great conversation with the Uber driver on the way to the airport, and we talked, and we found a lot in common about she's in IT, I'm in digital. Like, we have a lot of intersection in terms of like the work we do, and I learned a lot from that. So there's places and people that will surprise you, no matter where you go.
Yeah.
And then for me, I asked a lot of questions, like a ton of questions, you know, from different students that I was in class with, you know, from my different professors. I had already had, you know, the work experience, but I needed the technical experience, you know, to push my, you know, to push my career forward. I made sure that I was probably one of the very few during Zoom with my camera on, you know, and just making sure that I was always visible, making sure that the teachers, you know, knew who I was, because they're definitely, you know, they're definitely paying attention. And that was pretty much it. Just being myself, making sure that I was prepared for class, making sure that, again, my teachers just, you know, they knew who I was. As it relates to my relationship with the NRF, this catapulted me to like, I want to say like national recognition. You know, I landed my job at Prada because of this. You know, so it's, again, you never know who you're gonna meet, you know, when you're, you know, when you're crossing paths. It's, you know, it's an amazing experience to even be recognized by some of you all here, but then also on my, in my school campus at Columbia College Chicago, you know, to be able to, you know, to speak to them about it and just really, you know, just hone in and discuss with them, you know, what this means. This is such an amazing, amazing opportunity, and I wouldn't be on the panel with these three amazing people, you know, without the NRF.
Yeah. Hey, Robert, I want to answer your second question because I totally forgot. But so the NRF, and this is a cool story. So when we applied for the Next Generation Scholarship, the case study was on PetSmart. It was designing a drive aisle. And so I put a lot of work into it, made this whole thing, and then of course we moved on. We got to the finals where Miss Amaya Sims took home the trophy, the gold, but of course. And I think it was awesome because I look back with nothing but fondness for being able to share this connection and with so many other great, excellent students. And it gave me the confidence. Mm-hmm. Hey, I could do this. I didn't think I could, but I could do it. And the best part is the recruiter for PetSmart saw my case study, reached out. I think you'd be great for this role. We want you. And that's how I got my job. So pretty straightforward.
That's amazing. Just a quick follow-up for Eugene or Courtney. Many college students are apprehensive about relocating for new career opportunities. Is there any advice that you can give them on how relocating may be a worthwhile opportunity?
Yeah, so right after college, I relocated to San Francisco. And I understand at some points in your career, there may be a time where you feel very apprehensive to relocate, whether it be you're in a partnership or you have kids that are in the local school district. Like, there will be times where you do not want to relocate, and that makes perfect sense. I personally feel that your early 20s or your first job after college is not the time to feel that way or hold yourself back from it. It's very normal to have that kind of, I'm nervous, big city, new friends, like how do I do this, and a new job. Like, it's really a big deal, don't get me wrong. But what better way and time to do that than when you're surrounded by people who are in the same situation? Mm-hmm. So for my example, when I joined a cohort, that really helped me. So my training program had 18 other people that were in my exact same position that came from all different states. And we were in this new city and the apartments were small and we're paying a lot for rent. Like, it was a whole new world and we were all in it together. So that kind of acclimated me and got me very excited to take this on. So I recommend if you're having those kind of feelings of apprehension of moving or relocating, just try and find the bright side. Like, realize that you have nothing to lose. It's an exciting time to do this. And worst case, you don't like it and you move somewhere else. Yeah. So I highly recommend just taking advantage of the relocation process, and you can find people who are in your same situation no matter where you go.
Yeah, piggybacking off that, I think it's all about staying open-minded and willing to experience kind of those new experiences. And for me, I wanted that hybrid role to be able to kind of go into the office, pet a lot of dogs. I pet a lot of dogs at PetSmart. and so relocating there, it's actually funny because you went to school in Arizona and then went to the Bay. I went to school in the Bay, so I went from a big city to a hot city. It was 115 degrees the day I moved in. And so it was a little bit to get accustomed to, but I found a lot of joy in just being able to truly just put my roots somewhere new. And that was part of the fun of just putting yourself out there and learning new things about a different state, a different culture while you're there. Because and being okay that, hey, maybe this isn't a permanent state. But it's something that you can say you did and then be more comfortable, be more adaptable the next time, you know, an offer comes in or a move comes in along the line.
Thank you. What is something most students wouldn't know about your job role, but should?
Do you want to take this one?
Sure, I'll take this one. And for the previous question, I didn't relocate after college, but I still support it. Right. As far as being a stylist, I think the number one thing that people don't know is you hear a stylist, it's not as glamorous as one would think, and it does require a good amount of studying, dedication, and time to level up and take your career in the various fields and paths that styling has to offer, which is, I think, is another point that a lot of people don't know. There are various facets of styling. You can be a stylist for a retailer, work in-house, style their clients as they come in, or you can also be a corporate stylist, work in e-commerce, editorial, and then also, if you want to start small, you can be your own personal stylist online from Instagram, TikTok, and create your field of clients without even leaving your home. So that's one of the things that I did in undergrad, was start small, work my way up, network with other classmates that were in various other career fields, whether they were in an undergraduate in TV or film or production or even journalism, and work with them for their portfolio and kind of create together to build a book of work that we could use when interviewing for various jobs.
I can answer it. So as a department manager, I'm over my entire department. So that's women's shoes, handbags, ready-to-wear, accessories, fragrance, the whole nine. I am literally in charge of how things are coming into my store and why they're leaving my store. There's a multitude of reasons that something could leave the store. It could be a transfer to another store because size availability. It could be, you know, for a charge send. I have to be on top of that. I also have to be on top of what's coming into my store. I have to be able to speak to my merchants and, you know, my buyers, some here in New York, some that are in, you know, that are in Italy, about why I need certain pieces, you know, into my store. You know, I have to be able to speak about my customers outside of, oh, she was really great and she was looking for a dress. I have to be able to speak to price hesitation, you know, fabrications, you know, and things of that nature. So the role gives me a chance to deal with the customer in true, you know, in true totality, you know, from the item coming from Italy and to it getting into, you know, into my store. Do either one of you guys want to?
Yeah, I can add from a corporate retail perspective, this is no surprise, I'm sure, but a lot of cross collaboration that my role in supply chain and merchandise planning comes across every single day. I mean, I think something that no one would really know outside my four walls is how much I'm talking to our team in Asia, who is the liaison between our headquarters in San Francisco and our factories all around the world. And I'm talking to our design team and our product development team out in Portland, and I'm working with logistics and more supply chain and the finance team about financial targets in our San Francisco headquarters. So we're just constantly so cross-functional, which you'll hear that word, it sounds like a buzzword, but it's very true in a lot of these roles, just how many teams you're touching. And it truly feels like my role is this nucleus to really touch and impact so many parts of the business. And that's what really keeps me kind of fired up and passionate, because every day is very different based on who you're talking to and what project you're working on.
Courtney, you better not keep stealing things I'm going to say, all right? I think for me then, I think it's just about never stop learning in my role. And I came in, you know, so like fresh, and I had a lot of great ideas to offer. But, you know, of course, you come in and you don't know what to do. Like, you don't know where to start. And that's where you ask for help and you ask for guidance and you find a good manager who will help you grow. And you learn a lot of that yourself. And I always thought I'd get to a point where I'm like, I know exactly what I'm doing every day. Like, if I go into the office, I know exactly what I'm going to do today, 9 to 5 or 8 to 5. And like, I'll feel confident. I feel like an expert. But the more you learn, the more you realize there's so much you don't know. Mm-hmm. And challenging yourself to continue to learn, to continue to train yourself, and really just become a generalist in terms of like the kind of projects that you take on and work on.
That's good.
Thank you. What stories can you share that demonstrate how people early in their careers can impact change in the business or present new ideas, even if they are just starting out?
Yep, I have a good example for this one. Sorry, I keep taking the mic first.
That's great.
So when I first started at Athleta, the Athleta customer is typically about 45 to 60 years old. And we were really, this was back in like 2018 when I first joined, we were really going after a younger customer. So they really looked to myself and a couple other newcomers that were in my generation that was not our current customer or target. So they looked to us and said like, hey, you're our exact demographic. You have our psychographics. You have everything that we're trying to get after. Go create the next comp analysis. Like, go tell us who is out there that your exact demographic, psychographic customer is shopping. And we were able to really pull together with some teamwork of some colleagues of mine to be able to say, this is the like competitor analysis. This is what's out there. And if we want to go after a younger customer, this is who you're working with and who you have to compete with. So we were really able to bring that to the table and deliver something that felt really important to the company's initiatives at such an early stage in my career.
That's really good. What I got?
Go ahead.
Okay. The biggest thing that comes to mind with this is just being not scared of being vocal and sharing your thoughts. When I was working on the Next Gen case study, I was also having an internship with Kohl's at their buying office. And I would think to myself, I need to keep these separate. Like, you know, they don't intertwine at all, or there's nothing similar about them. But it wasn't until I actually told my manager what I was working on and how it related to allocation that she gave me a bigger project to work on. And she was really engaged and actually cared about what I was doing. And it just goes to show that when you're first starting out, your managers and leaders, they are asking you your opinion. They want to hear your questions. They value your thoughts because you're a fresh set of eyes coming into the industry. And you shouldn't second guess yourself, and you shouldn't succumb to that kind of like imposter syndrome and be afraid of putting yourself out there and sharing your views and your opinions, because at the end of the day, it's definitely needed.
Definitely. I think my favorite memory or just project when I first started at PetSmart as a rotational. And that means that we were kind of given mini internships, 10-week stops in each department. And one of the ones I landed on was integrated marketing. And when I started the rotation, I was given a project to support a brand launch for dog toys, which is about as fun as it sounds. And it was a huge, like, multi-million dollar plan, of course. And so I was kind of assigned to support that. My manager went on maternity leave a couple weeks after that. So by choice not having a choice also, I stepped up and kind of filled that role to guide our partners through that process, to create the marketing strategy brief, and really just initiate conversations about this brand. It's called Joyhound. It's in stores, it's online today. But it was so, so exciting. And every time I see that name pop up in my email, I think back and I think, wow, like, I helped drive that. I asked questions about that. I spoke up about it fresh in the company. And so that, never take your influence for granted.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Alrighty, this one's for everyone. What's the coolest, most exciting experience you've had to date in your retail career?
Okay. my favorite part about being a stylist is anytime that I'm on set with ShopBop, I work closely with their pre-production team. So we take product that is being prepared for the website, and seeing how quickly product moves from creation to pre-production to the e-commerce team and then fulfillment, and being able to put all of that together for the website and for the consumer to enjoy is always a pleasure. And then prior to that, I was part of a short film production. And seeing actors wear the things that I've put together from various retailers is such a pleasure, and something that I don't think I'll ever get over.
Yeah, I mean, I spoke about the PetSmart one, so I'll think of a different one further back. So sewing party, we got invited to go to a couple trade shows in France and England, in London and Nantes, and the CEO picked me to go with her. Might have been some nepotism involved, but I remember just helping out at those shows and as a vendor, and just being so amazed and inspired by just, you know, there's just so many markets in this world that is not just what you are living in, and there's so much like values and cultures and different kinds of products out there in the world. So that was a really great experience.
For me, it's kind of outside of the store, but it's actually sitting on the board for the NRF. You know, it's the first time that, you know, the Top Runner was allowed, you know, to do that. And it's an amazing experience, because I was once sitting where you guys were. And to be able to offer, you know, these higher ups, the student perspective of, you know, everything that you go through and the ups and downs and literally everything in between to, you know, to them, because they don't always hear it, is something that is something that I value, you know, and I was super, super excited to do it. Inside of the store, I get the, again, I get the opportunity to work with the retailers and merchants, not just email, but also in person. So I'm sitting on one side of the table and then four of them are asking me questions about different things that are going on in my store, you know, product-wise, and to have that opportunity for them to value what it is that I'm bringing to the table, value my, you know, my perspective is something that is just absolutely amazing. Alrighty. Can you talk about the importance of career development and mentorship? Can you share opportunities at your company that help you grow?
Yeah, I mean, it's no secret to say how important mentorship is as you're looking to develop in your career. I'm currently very fortunate to consider my manager a mentor, but that will not always be the case. And a lot of the time you have to make that extra outreach to find that mentorship. And with my rotational program that I joined right after college, we were essentially given a manager for each position that we were trying out. And that manager appointed you to another mentor to kind of get the ball rolling. So there's a lot of companies that do have that organized in terms of like you start somewhere, here's a manager, here's a mentor. And then you move on to the next, here's a manager, here's a mentor. And you really start to understand who you do and don't click with and who's really gonna be there to listen and provide you with those opportunities of what you need to help with your growth. But a lot of that starts with you and knowing what you want and how you're gonna get it, and then just find the right person who's going to listen and support you and give you those opportunities. So I would say ultimately, companies can kind of give you a step in that direction, but it's gonna be up to you to really vocalize what it is you need and how you wanna progress the way that you dream of progressing.
Yeah, no, I think it's really important. I think I almost feel like I cheat on my mentors by how many mentors I try to get. just trying to learn from many people, and I even saw someone added me on LinkedIn right now. So I mean, like, hopefully, if you're looking for a mentor, I'm happy to help.
I second that. I agree with everything that you guys have said. Yeah, beautiful.
Career devil. I would say probably my most influential mentor to date has been my advisor from school, Dana Connell. I'm not sure if she's in the audience, but she, you know, it's one thing to have a teacher teach. It's something completely different to have a teacher really pour and invest into you. And that's just something that I literally have taken with me as I was at Columbia and then also in my career, you know, at Prada right now. So we're gonna open it up for a Q&A from you guys. I'm sorry. I'm not the best with transitions.
I'm from the University of Alabama, and I have a question for all of you. Is obviously this is a very competitive field, and a lot of us have similar things on our resume, and we struggle to figure out how to stand out in this competitive field. What are some things that y'all did to help you stand out? And in the face of rejection, how did you stay motivated?
That's a good one.
Well, I could. So in my interviews, I always wore a hat. That was the thing. No, seriously, that was the thing that set me apart from, you know, from everyone else. I think if you're nervous about something, speak to that. If you're not sure about something, speak to that. Oftentimes when you're being recruited for a job or you're doing interviews, you know, they don't want perfection, they want authenticity. You know, so I'm very conversational when I, you know, when I speak. Rejection happens, it's a part of life. You know, it's, I tell my husband, I'm like, you get 10 minutes to sulk and then we have to move on to, you know, you move on to you move on to the next thing. And I think what keeps propelling me is there's somewhere that I want to go. There's something bigger that I'm trying to, you know, that I'm trying to do. And that's what keeps me moving.
Yeah. I think one thing that helped me stand out, I'm a bit of a stalker on LinkedIn. So whenever there is an application or there's a job that I want or a new client that I want to connect with, I find their LinkedIn or a connection of theirs and I reach out and I just say, hey, I'm interested in your company. I'm interested to learn what you do, just to get to know them a little bit and ask them, you know, what are some things that you're looking for in potential clients? Don't be afraid to shoot your shot and connect with people. And as far as to make yourself comfortable doing it, I would say as corny as it sounds, I think dressing your best is gonna make you feel confident and make you feel your most powerful. Whatever that looks like, don't be afraid to try to, or don't think that you have to fit the mold of a certain look. Be you and stand strong in that.
Yeah, yeah, no, that's a great point. I think it comes down to confidence, and one of my favorite quotes is, be who you are and be that well. Mm-hmm. Like, do that well, think about your strengths often, and you know, if you get rejected from a company, that's their loss. You know, something I do is before interviews, about to get really vulnerable, I put Roar by Katy Perry on full blast. I'm like, yeah, I feel it. I'm ready to go. And I jump into that interview and give it the best that I can, and I have no regrets on what happens next.
Yeah.
That's good. I honestly be aggressive. Like, that sounds crazy, but when I knew I wanted my job with Gap, I showed up to every single information session they had on my campus. I went to 2 in one day. One time, so much to the point that the recruiter was like, we know you want the job, we look forward to hearing you in the interview, like, please leave. So I really showed up. Like, you just show up, show out, like, give it your best, and be passionate when you talk to people. Like, remember, absolutely, the recruiters just want a human interaction. Yeah. Like, they want to just get to know you. So I just be aggressive, but be yourself.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Speed run.
Okay, hi. So my name is Lindsay, and I'm a student at Mississippi State University, but I have a question for Amaya. As a business owner, what is something that you did that was pivotal early on in building your business, or is there something that you wish you would have done earlier?
That's a good one. Early on, one of the things that helped me build my business completely was the program that I chose for my master's. It was focused entirely around building your business plan, and I don't think if I didn't have that program, it probably wouldn't have been as strong as it was now. So if you don't have a program or you're not looking to get your graduate degree, what I would do first is focus on what your business plan is, what it's going to be, you know, your unique value proposition that is going to stand you out from another business. What is the thing that makes you different? What's something that a client's going to say, oh, I want to buy from her, or I want to get her service? What's that thing that makes you you and your business yours, apart from something that's already in the market?
Awesome. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Noelle Mineo. I'm from Long Island, New York, and I'm currently finishing my master's in business at the University of Alabama. Sorry, I have another question directly for Amaya. I'm curious, from an entrepreneurship experience, what were the biggest mental and financial burdens or hurdles that you had to overcome in the early stages of your career, and how did you do so?
The mental struggles were strong. I think the biggest thing that I had to get over was the lack of confidence and self-doubt. Being an entrepreneur, every day there's going to be something that you're unsure of, or that you don't know what you're going to do, whether it's taxes, whether it's how do I hire this person, how do I find the company to get this, or where do I get this supply from? There's always going to be something, and I think if, as corny as it sounds again, taking it day by day and focusing on the small things that are the building block of your foundation is what's going to make all of the difference, and not trying to be overwhelmed with where you want to be in 5 years or 10 years. Focus on what your 6 month plan is, and then from there, break it down to what can I do day by day to get to a month, and then build that and scale it as you go. And as far as financial, again, every day there's going to be something that you need to spend money for, but I think there are so many small business grants out there that there are companies that are literally looking to give out money for business owners. Apply for those, look in your county, your town, your state, and you'll be set.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm Yvonne from Columbia College. I loved hearing about all your successes, but could you share some of your failures and how they help change your perspective?
Yeah, ooh. I love that question, and I'm passionate to take that one. and this is hopefully relatable to a lot of you in the building, or maybe hopefully not, but I had my heart set when I was a junior in college of getting the Nike internship. I was dead set, let me tell you. I was walking around campus acting like I already had the job. Like, I was so confident, and I weared it proudly. I was like, yep, I'm confident, here I go. But wow, did I get to the last round and get rejected, and I felt like I had lost my whole purpose. Like, I was so dead set, and it was a big failure. I really felt like I had this 15-minute presentation, final round. Here's the recruiters right in front of me. I'm going to give them my final project. And when it came back as a no, I was honestly shocked, and it really helped me like pick myself up, humble myself a little bit, to be honest, and be able to say, like, let me stay open-minded and look at other companies. And it really worked out that I could join a training program that Gap offered, blah, blah, blah. And it just wasn't meant to be, but it was definitely at the time felt like my biggest failure, but it was really meant to be as I look back on my journey.
Yeah. I kid you not, I was gonna say the same thing.
Did you read my notes? Is that
no,
why?
No, no. Maybe I'm just plagiarizing. But I really wanted a Nike internship, and I was also making it to the final round, and it didn't work out. And I ended up going with my second choice, which was Target. And that was a store management internship. It wasn't related to my major, which was marketing. And so I was a little hesitant about it, but luckily, like, it still continued during COVID, and I went in with an open mind, thinking I had just failed and wasted a summer, you know, but it taught me so much about what store associates do every day, really the backbone of the business for a lot of retailers. It taught me a lot about the customer lens. How do people shop? Like, what kind of data do we need to look at to make that happen? So I'm really grateful for that failure.
Yeah, I'll be quick. I think one of the things that has helped me overcome failures is just remembering that every single no you get is just getting you one step closer to a yes. You might have 1,000 no's, but giving up, you might have gotten to that 1,001, and that might have been your yes.
My biggest failure was not advocating for myself. You know, I come from a generation where it is you show up to work on time every day, whether you have a leg hanging off or if you're not feeling well, you come to work. And my biggest mistake was not setting proper work balances and work boundaries, you know, with I will not be texted after, you know, after a certain time. And I think that's what you can take into, you know, not, I don't want to say failure for yourself, is being able to advocate for yourself, being able to, you know, speak up for yourself. And that was one of the biggest lessons that I learned, you know, in my career. I don't have to do it all. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm able to say, you know, I'm tired, I'm exhausted, or I'm not at 100%, and be able to speak to my bosses, you know, about that, as opposed to taking it on and not doing it to the best of my ability.
Oh. All right. My name is Leah Tabor. I'm also from the University of Alabama. I'm majoring in management information systems, but I was just curious. I know, Amaya, you already got to sort of touch on this, but what regrets do you guys have, especially as young professionals, like being taken seriously and like having imposter syndrome, kind of approaching that, and just how do you wish you maybe would have approached it, or if you think you did it well, like, would you like to share that with us as well?
Yeah, I think there's a fine line between, how do I say this? I think there's a lot of good that comes from just asking questions. So there's a fake it till you make it mentality, but only till a certain point. Mm-hmm. So you take that fake it till you make it, you get yourself in the door, sure, you have the confidence, but have the ability to say, I don't know what I'm doing and I need to ask questions, or I need support in this direction. And that should really be able to break you down and then get those resources to build your way back up. Mm-hmm. So I'll kind of leave it at that, but I think there is that fine line, fake it till you make it, but not to the point where you're holding yourself back from asking questions and actually learning mm-hmm. to have the confidence to really feel like you know what you're doing.
Yeah.
The best room to be in is where you're not the smartest. Mm. So be humble, but be curious.
Mm-hmm. I agree. Yeah, I'll just say there's definitely a degree of humbleness that you have to have when trying to figure out and navigate imposter syndrome versus being confident.
Mm-hmm. I second and third that.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Well, that's going to conclude our panel.